So I think we can get started gradually. Everyone, welcome. So tonight, we'll hear a lecture about the death penalty in 18th century Russia, an unusually unpredictable century in an unusually unpredictable country, with our guest speaker, Lena Marasinova. Lena Marasinova is a leading researcher at the Russian Academy of Sciences and a professor at the High School of Economics and also, as of now, correct me if I'm wrong, visiting professor at the University of Illinois in Chicago. And it would take the whole evening to enumerate everything Lena Marasinova has written. So I'll just mention three monographs, and probably you'll speak about some of them today. They are The Law and Citizen in the Second Half of 18th Century Russia, State and Personality Essays of the Russian History of the 18th Century, and Psychology of the Russian Noble Elite of the Last Third of the 18th Century. So please, welcome Lena Marasinova, whose lecture on the death penalty has for a long time been on my bucket list.
What is the better? Thank you very much for your invitation and presentation. It's really honorable for me to deliver lecture at Barnard College. And I'd like to give you some words about my three monographs. For the beginning, as it was mentioned, there were three ones. The first was titled Social Psychology of the Russian Nobility of the 18th Century. And I researched the social psychology and the mentality of the Russian nobility on the basis of private correspondence. After it, I was very interested in the following problem. How Russian state figure out to manipulate of the consciousness and value systems of the whole estate and create a special estate which main subject of honor was the serf for motherland and Tsar or later emperor. So my now I show you title. It was the first book dealing with the social psychology of the Russian nobility. And the title of this book is The State and Personality in Russian 18th Century. And this book correspondingly was dealing with the mechanism of social control and the main channels of the manipulation of the consciousness of the Russian upper estate. And the third book was devoted to the political language of this period. I tried to investigate the semantic content of very important notions of the Russian language of that period, such as subject, slave law, death penalty, political death, and so on. My report today is titled The Death Penalty in 18th Century Russia. And if you can read in Russian, there is some materials of this report in the first chapter of this book. The title of this chapter Law of Gods or Divine Law and the Law of State. Very complicated correspondence and maybe cohesion between these two spheres of legislation. In addition, I wrote one article of our common book, Early Modern Prayer. This book has been published in the United Kingdom. And I wrote here article, The Prayer of Empress and the Death Penalty Moratorium in 18th Century Russia. I wrote one article in a rather famous journal, Critica. Maybe you know this journal, Exploration in Russian History, Punishment by Penance in 18th Century Russia. I decided to divide my report today into two parts, which correspond to the main features of attitudes to the death penalty in the period of 18th century, and in the period of three main reigns of this century. The century the reign of Peter the Great, then the reign of his daughter Elizabeth, and at last the age of Catherine the Great. So the first chapter of my article, The Last Judgment and the Capital Punishment, I'd like to research the connection between tradition and innovation in the period of Peter the Great and attitudes of the state and contemporaries to the problem of the death penalty. It should be noted that under Peter the First, so-called All Russian legislation promulgated in 1649 in Russian Soborное уложение remained relevant at that period and was law in force, especially in the sphere of penal and criminal legislation. In accordance with this all Russian legislation, there were several types of death penalty in Russian law. Here you can see engraving of a traveler, Adam Aliarius. Adam Aliarius visited Russia in 17th century, and after it he wrote the book, memoir, description of the journey of the Holstein embassy to Moscow and Persia. The name of this engraving, Kremlin and Punishment. This picture does not show the everyday life of Muscovite people near the walls of the Kremlin. This engraving show us the different types of the death penalty of this period. Some kind of small illustrated encyclopedia of the Russian penal legislation. For example, breaking on the will was proposed as punishment for murder in the presence of the Tsar. Then, bandits were to be hanged by the whip. Then, counterfeiters correspondingly will have molten lead poured down their throat. And arsonists and those failing to report them were to be burnt. You can see here some kind of connection between the types of crime and the types of punishment. However, it's very important that the types of death penalty in Russia in this period and in previous centuries correspond to the notion of punishment at the last judgment. You can see here the icon of last judgment. There were a lot of variations of this canonical iconography. However, every type this icon has special basement. And this special basement with the pictures of torments and tortures of sinners in hell is the most interesting aspect for us now. You can see this picture a little bit larger, and I'd like to show you another type of basement of the icon of the Last Judgment or Doomsday from the 16th century. It's interesting that according to the Russian religious views and consciousness, the unburied, dismembered, and blinded criminal could not rise again on Doomsday. So the types of death penalty was some kind of sign, not only of punishment criminals at the end of his life, but also continuous of this punishment after the death and in the crucial moment of the last judgment. For example, what environment was considered to be of a symbol of disbelief or its quotation, hellish undertaken of the enemies of Russian state. The leader of one uprising of peasants and Cossacks at the beginning of 17th century, Ivan Bolotnikov, was blinded and then drowned in the small northern Russian city Kargopol. It means he and his fellow fighters would not have any chance to rise again on doomsday. You can see here another fragment of the icons of the large judgment or doomsday, and some notions dealing with the destiny of the body of late convicts and criminals. It was forbidden to bury executed criminals in the ground. Sometimes their bodies were exposed to be eaten by wild animals. It was really very popular in the period of Ivan the Terrible. Maybe some of us know it. Boiling in the cauldron symbolized hellfire. You can see this hellfire and the torments of one sinner in hell after his death. During the reign of Anna Ivanovna, in the first part of the 18th century, the apostates from the Orthodox faith were burned at the stake. And in this icon, you can see also the stake in hell. And these fragments of the very important and popular icons and different types of punishment illustrated some parts of book of Revelation of Saint John, the Apocalypse, which was very popular in the clergy circles in the Russia of that period. It should be noted that this tradition was still alive in the period of Peter the Great. However, we can observe some innovation during the reign of the first Russian emperor. The matter is, at the end of the 17th century, Peter the Great and other members of the Russian political elite visited the Western Europe in so-called the Great Embassy. It was for the first time in Russian history when Russian Orthodox son visited Western Europe for study. Peter was a member of the Great Embassy as a timid bombardier with a nickname Peter Mikhailov, and he not only worked on a shipyard as a carpenter, but he also attended several times European anatomic theaters. He was excited and he decided to establish the first anatomic theater in new capital of Russia, St. Petersburg. It's my summary of this part. The punishment of criminal's body became prototype of his torments in the afterlife. But now we can go to the period of Peter the Great. He invited Nicolaus Bidlow, the famous Dutch physician, and he became the first medical teacher and instructor in Russian anatomic theater. Peter opened so-called Kunstkamera in German, a cabinet of curiosities dedicated to preserving natural and human rarities. It became the first Russian museum. And as early as in 1706, during the Sweden North War, Peter ordered the body of late executed criminals and convicts to be sent to the anatomical theater and Kunstkamera. You can see here the head presumably of an executed criminal was an exhibit of this museum. I am so sorry for this suffering and bloody theme, but as for me, capital punishment is very important aspects of the history of all periods and states, and this approach can open us new perspectives of the investigation of the past. So we can continue, and I'd like to show you one picture which can help us to understand deeper complicated dichotomy between the punishment of body and the punishment of spirit of that period, and attitudes of Peter the Great to the capital punishment in the period of early Russian Enlightenment. You can see here folk picture or woodcut in Russian lubok. One unknown common merchant from small town near Moscow painted this folk picture. Folk picture showed us the history of the destiny of poor Lady Hamilton, mistress of Peter the Great. There were a lot of gossips and rumors in St. Petersburg that Lady Hamilton killed the common child, and it should be noted that there were not real and truth evidence of this punishment. By the way, Lady Hamilton was sentenced to the death penalty by beheading. Peter the Great attended this poor event, and after the execution, according to the members of the contemporaries, he took the head of Lady Hamilton and kissed her lips, and after it delivered a lecture for the people near Scaffold about the structure of the human body, because he was an enlightened monarch. And you can see here this crucial moment of this history and the lecture of Peter the Great. The head of Lady Hamilton was preserved for several decades in Kunstkamera. But Russian history is and was rather unexpected, and the next part of my lecture, a prayer of the Russian Empress, abolition of the death penalty in 18th century Russia. After the centuries of really bloody and terrible legislation, especially its penal and criminal part, Russia knew two decades of moratorium of death penalty. Not a single execution took place throughout the entire two decades of the Russian Empress Elizabeth, from 1741 to 1761. However, this royal decision met very different and complicated impressions and perceptions. For example, according to the French diplomat and man of letters, Joseph de Maistre, Elizabeth's abolition of the death penalty was nothing but false philanthropy and sign of national moral inferiority. However, Italian philosopher Cesare Beccaria took inspiration from the remarkable example of the Empress of Moscovia, and 3 years after her death published his work on crimes and punishments. He wrote in this essay about really remarkable example of the Russian Empress and compared this phenomenon with a sun in the darkness. But I'd like to give you some explanations dealing with the circumstances of the establishment of this moratorium. Here you can see family tree of Romanov dynasty. The problem is after the death of the parents of Elizabeth, Peter the First and Catherine the First, another branch of Romanov dynasty ascended the throne, and Anna Ivanovna was an empress during one decade, and then her successor, Anna Leopoldovna, became. However, after the death of Empress Anna Ivanovna, the regency of Anna Leopoldovna and she was a wife of one prince from Braunschweig dynasty. And this reign was marked by high taxes, economic crisis, a lot of peasants and Cossacks rebellions, and her court was almost entirely marked up of foreigners from Braunschweig House. So, the coup d'etat near the Russian throne became inevitable. And the leader of this coup d'etat and the main figure became Elizabeth. And here you can see the engraving on arrest of Anna Leopoldovna, and successful coup d'etat of Empress Elizabeth. According to the members, in early morning, before seizing the throne, she prayed before the icon of the Savior. It was the icon of her father, Peter the Great, and she vowed that if the coup was a success, she would abolish capital punishment. As we know, the coup was a success and the debt had to be paid. She promised and she have done. In 1742, the edict which suspends the carrying out of death sentences was published, but it's interesting that Empress Elizabeth wrote his edict just on the same piece of paper of the report presented her by the Senate. This edict about abolition or at least suspending the carrying out of the death sentences was hidden away at once and became a secret. Another edict for public consumption was issued, and here you can see the copy of this edict for public consumption. And this edict included just only one instruction. All local chanceries had to send descriptions of death sentences to the Senate, await further instructions. The situation was really strange and vague. All courts sentenced convicts and criminals to the death, but the death penalty did not carry it out. It's an interesting question about the perception of the political elite and especially Senate of the moratorium on the death penalty. Fairly speaking, the Senate did not approve this royal decision, and they attempt to persuade monarch and put forward several arguments. The first one, they stated that the number of murderers and convicts and bandits would be increasing. The second one, law obedient subjects, seeing the absence of the death penalty, would become inclined to insubordination. But Elizabeth answered with very laconic phrase, the death penalty not be carried out without royal confirmation. The contradiction between political elite and the Russian Empress became deeper in the period of the composition of a new law code, and especially chapter on executions, punishments, and fines. Here you can see the portrait of Elizabeth's state secretary, Adam Alsufiev. Before the composition, the beginning of the work of the composition of new law code, Adam Alsufiev proclaimed that Her Imperial Majesty commands that the death penalty not be inserted in this new code. However, the draft of the new articles revealed a total ignorance of the two decades of the moratorium on death penalty. The sphere of death sentences was expanded in that articles. And just the death of Elizabeth put the end to this very dangerous contradiction contradictions between the empress and political elite. It should be noted that the position of Russian Orthodox Church was very close to the position of the Senate. It may be some kind of feature of Russian political religious consciousness, this fact. The Holy Synod, it's a top bureaucratic office of the Russian Orthodox Church in the period of 18th century, suggested Elizabeth renounce her vow to God, that of suspending the death penalty. So the Holy Synod was ready to figure out relationship of the Empress and her God, and to interfere in it. So, and it's very important that Empress' decision to forbid carrying out death sentences without monarch's confirmation had to do with her own relationship with God. In this sphere, the Holy Synod was absolutely right. The Empress did not concern herself with the fates of the pardoned convicts. They would all die anyway, whether under the blows of the knout or due to back-breaking penal labor. Moreover, after the death of Elizabeth, the next empress, Catherine II, found out in the corner of the room of the Senate several thousands affairs dealing with the death penalty, which remained without any royal confirmation. And now the last part, the third part of my report, which is devoted to the reign of Catherine II from scaffold to penance. It's obvious that before her coup d'etat in 1762, she did not at all pray to any god. And she had absolutely another religious consciousness, maybe like Voltaire and other men of letters of the period of Enlightenment. After her accession of the throne, she wrote that the books of Montesquieu were to be considered the only Bible on the table of every enlightened monarch. However, she praised the abolition, tacit, implicit abolition on the death penalty of our aunt Elizabeth, it's a quotation from edict, as a decision more remarkable than the most glorious conquests. However, The first half of her reign was marked by three highly visible public and very loud executions carried out by beheading, quartering, and hanging. It's very important that after two decades of the moratorium on death penalty, the authorities needed to justify the restoration of the death penalty. And it's interesting that the arguments of the restoration of the death penalty became Christian doctrine. Christian doctrine became some kind of tool of the restoration of the death penalty. So three very important cases of the death penalties during the first half of the period of Catherine the Great. First, so-called affair of Lieutenant Mirovich, affair of rebellions, plague rebellions in Moscow of 1771, and of course, Cossacks rebellion under the guide of Pugachev. Lieutenant Mirovich was accused to attempting to bring to the throne Prince Ivan the Sixth, poor infant of Anna Leopoldovna Braunschweig, while the throne had been entrusted to Her Majesty by divine providence. Here you can see two engravings. One, it's a scene of the plague rebellion in Moscow, and another is a capital punishment by quartering in Bolotnaya Square of Pugachev. The participants of the 1771 uprising in Moscow were punished for the murder of Metropolitan Ambrosi, having thereby violated the law of the all-powerful Lord and Creator. They were punished by casting lots and hanging. The imposter Pugachev had on his conscience the abduction of the name of monarch. He proclaimed himself the survived husband of Catherine the Second, late Emperor Peter the Third. Maybe you know it. So he was a perpetrator of his hellish undertaking. However, just after the end of Pugachev rebellion, Catherine the Great confirmed the edict of Elizabeth of 1744. Historical sources of this decision is journals of imperial confirmations. So Catherine the Great confirmed that no one, no single death penalty could be carried out without the confirmation of Her Majesty. university. So early mornings in St. Petersburg in Winter Palace, she read not only the works of Voltaire and letters from Grimm. She read a lot of these sentences and wrote by her own hand her confirmation. Here you can see one of the first confirmation of Catherine the Second. She wrote it in French on one inquests of criminal affairs, and he wrote, induced to repent with the help of religious feelings. So, Russian Orthodox Church knew voluntary repentance, which had close connection with the confession and enforced repentance. However, what did Catherine's cabinet give, what kind of innovation did the Catherine's cabinets? Here you can see the wall of one Russian northern monastery, Kirillov Belozerski. And you can see here rooms or cells for convicts. First, the role of Catherine the Second in using church practices in the process of punishment of subjects was really remarkable. The second one, she gave secular courts the prerogative of sentencing subjects to penance. Then, penance could be combined in various configurations with penal labor, exile, recruitment into the army without rank for Russian nobility. And the last one, the clergy took no part in the decision to punish a layman. However, they will merely perform the functions of supervisors in monastery. And many monasteries received new very important functions, and they became, in addition, prisons. You can see here this one, the cells of convicts in monastery. And maybe the last phenomenon case of my lecture. Catherine's cabinet were able to revive the ancient tradition of public penance. They had elaborated a stage interpretation of the canonical rite. It should be noted, Russian Orthodox Church did not know at all public penance. The problem is when Kievan Russia adopted Christianity in Byzantium, public penance did not exist. However, Catherine the Great and her state secretaries elaborated so-called theatrical imitation of the ancient public penance on the stage of Russian Baroque theater. You can see here the fragments of public penance in Kremlin, not far from cathedral, the main cathedral in Kremlin and in Russia in general, Assumption or Dormition. And the process of this public penance. It was a public penance of two murderers who killed their mother and young sister. And now some conclusions. Dealing with the first part of my lecture. The punishment of criminal's body was a prototype of his suffering in the afterlife or on doomsday. What can we conclude dealing with the phenomenon of two decades moratorium on death penalty? Of course, the religious feelings of Elizabeth was the feelings of a private person. All curious details of her religious life would have remained the intimate experience of a single private person. Had this person not been an empress ruling the autocratic empire. On the one hand, the coronation rite lent a special exaltation to any Russian monarch, not only all Russian subjects of that period. On the other, the will of the sovereign was considered to be the fundamental law. Not just the will, just even religious feeling. And the last one. Church practices in punishing subjects were conditioned by the humanization of and moderation of criminal law according to the ideas of the Enlightenment. The object of punishment became not the body, but the convict's spirit. And in this moderation, and humanization of the criminal law, the Russian Orthodox Church played not the first role, but just a tool or instrument of the implementation of the enlightened view of Catherine's cabinet. Thank you very much for your attention.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we have now some 10, 15 minutes for questions. Would anyone like to start? Any questions? Perhaps I'll be the first one to ask you one. You mentioned Cesare Bigali and his work, which Catherine the Great read when working on her great instruction about the about the bane of death penalties, about the necessity of avoiding them.
Mm-hmm.
But Russia was the country which was the first one to, among European empires, to come up with the, with this moratorium. So it turns out that Russia, so it turns out this practice originated in Russia,
mm-hmm.
but then another Russian empress, Catherine, had to wait for a European
mm-hmm.
to interpret this
mm-hmm.
practice and then take it from a European,
yes.
and she had to refer to a European rather than to her predecessor. Could you comment on that?
Yes, it's really as for me, very interesting phenomenon because, of course, Elizabeth established a moratorium on death penalty. But the main impulse of this empress was not the enlightenment. Enlightened ideas and deep thinking on the necessity to reduce tortures or maybe to abolish the public way of the death penalty. It was just real her agreement with her God and her religious feelings. However, this moratorium was tacit and implicit. And just to the end of her reign, some common people began to understand that the death penalty had been abolished. But Russia have absolutely no social landscape. During the reign of Catherine the Great and Elizabeth, and it's interesting when Russian troop entered to the Europe in 1830 during the Napoleon Wars, Russian soldiers and officers failed to recognize in one very strange structure scaffold. They did not know how scaffold could look. And the Western Europe saw that moratorium became a reality and the Russian Empire still alive. And Bikaria achieved the suspension of the death penalty in Toscana and Pavia in Italy under the example of Elizabeth. But Elizabeth did not know about it. It happened after her death. And of course, Catherine the Great received a lot of ideas from the essay of Beccaria and included many articles to the instruction to the Legislative Commission in 1766. However, there was some kind of gap between philosophical works of Catherine the Great and the the reality. These three affairs of the death penalty were cases of self-defense of power. And when we are speaking about the danger to the Russian throne, Catherine the Great understood not ideas of Bekaria, but the necessity of self-defense.
Thank you so much. Any other questions from our guests?
Was there any concern about reincarnation of the criminal soul in some other form, such as an animal or some other person, or even reincarnation as a devil itself, I guess, right?
According to maybe you know Orthodox belief, it's not reincarnation. It's some kind of arising for new spirit life in the period of the last judgment and on doomsday. But according to the as for me, superstition and very specific religious doctrine, former criminals could not rise again if their body was punished by quartering, for example. It looks like not deep religious doctrine, but rather superstitions. Not reincarnation, but really rising for new spirit life.
Can you talk a little bit about the public penance? Because you said that it was introduced after Russia converted to Christianity, right? And when was it? Was it introduced from the Catholicism that was brought? And why did Catherine choose to revive that practice? Like, what role did it play?
As for me, this was not a real restore the ancient right of public penance. It was so-called Baroque theater because I mentioned that about several thousand affairs accumulated in the corner of the Senate after the death of Elizabeth and two decades of moratorium on the death penalty. And Catherine the Great decided to look through some of these affairs, and she found out the history of very cruel and really awful murder commitment by two murderers, Zhukov. And she decided to organize to stage really public penance in Kremlin, and for the beginning she asked the top of Russian priests in the Holy Synod what kind of public penance existed in ancient ancient Russia, and they answered ancient Russia did not know any public penance. Okay, answered Catherine, and her state secretaries, and they wrote themselves the guide of this theatrical imitation of the ancient public penance.
We have another question from a gentleman in the back.
So I understood that the abolition of death penalty was a religious Christian idea for Elizabeth. And do you have any knowledge about death penalty being condemned in Christian thought before this? I wonder where did she get that idea? One possibility which comes to my mind is in the Tale of Bygone Years, an Ernesto Chronicle, where it's the story of temporary suspension of death penalties under Vladimir, Saint Vladimir, but even that is told not in the sense of it having been a good decision, but like a temporary mistake.
Your question dealing with the previous centuries and the tradition. Yes. Given Russia actually did not know the tradition of the death penalty. Because according to the ancient legislation, there were the right of relevance to kill somebody who hurted this big families or member of this families. And the tradition of the death penalty came to Kiev and Russia from the Byzantine legislation. But we can trace the real legislation of the death penalty since the reign of Grand Prince Ivan the Third, and real for the beginning of the history of Muscovite state from the 8th of 15th century.
Well, unless there is someone else willing to ask a question, let me thank you all for coming, especially Lena Marasinova, for this wonderful lecture, and we could proceed socially with the hors d'oeuvre. Thank you once again.
Thank you very much.